One of the things we need to do is always remember that the scriptures need to be understood as one cohesive unit from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelations, and not extract and isolate individual verses and create a theology from that verse.
In order to arrive at a genuinely biblical perspective on what salvation means and requires, I think we need to ask ourselves whether the statements in our favorite verses, to put it this way, are disjunctive or conjunctive. When we read in Acts, for instance, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved," does this mean believe in the Lord Jesus and nothing else, a disjunctive interpretation? Or does it mean believe in such a way that leaves open further possibilities, a conjunctive interpretation? I think if we're not committed in advance to a certain kind of disjunctive interpretation, an honest reading of the New Testament will discover there a polyphony of voices speaking about salvation and its necessities in a number of ways. Earlier in Acts, for instance, we read Peter after Pentecost addressing the crowd of would-be converts. He doesn't say only to believe, but says, "Repent and be baptized."
Jesus also says it's not those who say, "Lord, Lord," who will enter the kingdom of heaven. Right? That's giving the Lord lip service. He says, "But those who do the will of my Father." The emphasis on the act. Okay? Those who do the will of my Father. Now, this is Jesus who is teaching us action, the acts, the value of something concrete. But not only there. You know, in St. Matthew's Gospel, where he speaks of the return of the Son of Man and how he separates the goat from the sheep. Right? He separates the goat from the sheep. And how are they separated? Right? And they're separated on the basis of their actions. Jesus talks about hunger. He talks about thirst. He talks about being a stranger, being naked, being in prison. And when the disciples ask, "Well, when did we feed you or give you to drink or visit you in prison or clothe you?" And he says, "You have done this to me when you've done it to the least of my brethren." Now, the emphasis here is clearly on concrete acts. Now, these are the words of Jesus. We're not talking about what St. Paul said. We're talking about what Jesus himself said as the basis of our salvation. So yes, there is faith. But as St. James says, you know, faith without works is dead.
Paul in Romans not only insists upon the necessity of calling upon the Lord, but reading this letter carefully, we find him speaking of justification in terms of faith, grace, and obedience. James, in his letter, insists almost aggressively upon the inseparability of faith and deeds. A faithful conjunctive reading of the whole scriptural witness, then, does not isolate out a single verse or set of verses and claim that this and this alone defines salvation. Rather, the patient, conscientious student of sacred scripture will aim to assemble and synthesize all of the relevant data. For the well-versed reader of St. Paul, who can quote, "We are saved by faith apart from works," I invite you to take another look and see if Paul is not talking there about a particular subset of works, namely the works of the Jewish law.
If we step back in history and we look at Martin Luther and we see where he's coming from, Martin Luther is informed by something called nominalism. In short, nominalism rejected ontological categories, that is, categories of being. So, for example, Scott Hahn, the biblical scholar, provides this example of nominalism. He says, imagine that there's a king and he's sitting on his throne and one brings a dog into court and he brings the dog up to the king and the king says to the dog, "I now pronounce you human." And the dog barks, whittles on the guard's foot and runs off. And we say, "Look at that wonderful human running away." That's nominalism. Whereas an ontological, participatory ontology, we could say, in which one becomes the thing that they're declared, it looks very different. So the dog is brought before the king. The king says, "I pronounce you human." And mysteriously, the dog begins to stand on his hind legs and maybe even starts saying a few words that make sense as he's being formed into becoming human. Now that is the teaching of salvation in the church. For Luther, all you had to do is have faith. All you had to do is be declared righteous. Whereas the church has taught, no, you can't separate the two. To have faith is to become something. And we could add to this that faith and love can never be separated. They go together because love is a type of seeing, as is faith, and the two coalesce and intermingle. And so one does not have faith, true faith, if one does not love. And one does not love if one does not have proper faith. These things go back and forth.
In the Catholic Church is always emphasized as a fundamental part of our spirituality is not just that we have faith, but that our faith needs to be concretized in our actions. And this is why we have so many different charitable services in the Catholic Church, where even in the form of religious congregations, in the form of different institutes. Working for your salvation is a heresy called Pelagianism. And this was already condemned during the time of St. Augustine. So this goes back to an early 4th century heresy that had been condemned. And it condemns people believing that you can make your own choices, that you can assert yourself, that you are autonomous and independent and free-thinking, and save yourself. Okay, that's Pelagianism, and the church certainly condemns Pelagianism.
For our part, Catholics believe neither that persons are saved through faith apart from works, nor works apart from faith. Rather, we believe that the disjunction of faith and work is a false dichotomy. If faith is a living faith, it is the faith of a living, acting human person. Faith apart from action is dead, and vice versa, because a human apart from faith or action, one way or another, is also dead. Maybe a corpse with a heartbeat, no faith, or without one, no action.
And this is the problem of Pelagianism. It emphasizes individual self-assertion, individual autonomy, and not the work of grace. And Catholics know very well, whatever good works I do, they are the work of grace.